komputasi yang mumpuni sehingga mampu bersaing baik pada level nasional maupun internasional. Lulusan Departemen Statistika IPB disiapkan untuk mampu menerjemahkan permasalahan nyata dalam suatu bidang ilmu ke dalam konteks statistika dan sebaliknya mampu menerjemahkan hasil analisis dan kesimpulan yang ditarik secara statistika ke dalam bidang ilmu yang bersangkutan serta memiliki landasan yang kuat untuk mengembangkan keilmuan dan atau mengikuti pendidikan lanjut dalam bidang statistika atau bidang lain yang memerlukan penguasaan metode kuantitatif yang kuat.
Departemen Statistika IPB mempersiapkan kami, para mahasiswanya, untuk menjadi data scientist yang handal. Di Statistika IPB, kami diberikan bekal mengenai cara mengambil data, menganalisis, sampai menginterpretasikannya. Karena pada sejatinya, semua hal di dunia ini mengandung data, tak terkecuali hal terkecil sekalipun. Oleh karena itu, dengan kemampuan menganalisis data, maka berarti kami siap untuk bersaing di segala bidang. Statistika IPB, there is no statistics without variance.
Departemen Statistika IPB merupakan salah satu departemen terfavorit di Institut Pertanian Bogor. Menjadi bagian dari Departemen Statistika merupakan salah satu pencapaian terbaik dalam diri saya. Pembelajaran yang diberikan di Departemen Statistika terus mengalami pembaharuan seiring dengan berkembangnya zaman, khususnya di era Big Data. Lulusan statistik memiliki potensi tinggi memasuki dunia kerja, because statistic is a sexiest job.
Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to the main room of International Conference on Statistics and Data Science 2021. We now come to the plenary session 2. Before we go further to the session, the committee have prepared a video as an introduction to the parallel to the plenary session 2. Enjoy the video. The Ladies and gentlemen, we need your attention to kindly rename your ID name on your each screen using the format room_session_name according to the subject you will attend on the parallel session. For example, as after the plenary session, we will come to the session 2 and I will discuss in room 1 and my name is Sarah, then I will write 1_2_Sarah. The parallel session 2 will divide it into 3 rooms. Room 1 will discuss about survival analysis. Room 2 will discuss with subject, time series, and others. And room 3 will discuss about SAM and mixed models. Now, 3 honorable speakers are excited waiting to share with us on this beautiful day. They are Associate Professor Dr. Jayanti Arasan from University Putra Malaysia, Dr. Bagus Sartono, MSE from IPB, University of Indonesia, and Dr. Aswi from State University of Makassar, Indonesia. And the parallel session 2 will lead by Dr. Utami Dia Syafitri, SSE, MSE from IPB, University Indonesia. Allow me to read his curriculum vitae in advance. Dr. Utami Dia Syafitri, MSE is a lecturer at Department of Statistics, IPB University, Indonesia. Her expertise is in experimental design, optimal design, and chemometric modeling. She graduated her bachelor degree from IPB University at the year 2000 in statistics and her master of science in statistics at 2004 from IPB University Indonesia and PhD in applied economics from Antwerp University of Belgium at the year 2014. Ladies and gentlemen, let us together welcome Dr. Syafitri. The screen is yours.
Oh yeah, thank you, Ms. Sarah, for the nice introductions. Yes, Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good day, everybody. Welcome back to the plenary sessions. We are in the second plenary session now, and we have 3 outstanding speakers who will deliver interesting subjects. We have Associate Professor Jayanti Arasan from University Putra Malaysia, Dr. Bagus Sartono from IBB University, and Dr. Aswi from State University of Makassar, Indonesia. The 3 speakers are going to deliver a talk in line, and the session will close with the question and answer sessions. I would like to remind the audience, during the speakers deliver the talk, we encourage you to mute the audio and on-cam camera if possible, and use the event virtual microphones. Yeah. Now we are going to the first speaker. The first speaker is Associate Professor Jayanti Arasan from University Putra Malaysia. Yeah. Hello, Professor Arasan. How are you? Are you there?
Yes, I'm here. Can you hear me? I'm good.
Yes. Thank you. Okay, Professor Arasan is a lecturer at Department of Mathematics and Statistics, University Putra Malaysia. started from 2000 until now, her research area are survival analysis and computational statistics. Today, she will give a talk about modified diagnostic for survival regression model with rate and interval sensor data. So, Professor Arasan, time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Let me share my screen first.
Yes, please.
Okay, can you see my screen?
Yes, yes.
Okay, thank you so much to the moderator. That was a very kind introduction indeed, and a very good afternoon to ladies and gentlemen. It's indeed a pleasure to be here and share a bit of my research work entitled Modified Diagnostics for Survival Regression Model with Rate and Interval Sensor Data. This is a joint work between me and Professor Hafshamidi, and we are both from the University Putra of Malaysia. And I would like also to thank Dr. Anwar Fitrianto for inviting me for this conference. Indeed, a very wonderful conference. Thank you. And basically, this talk is about adjusting the currently used residuals in survival analysis using a computational approach and a multiple imputation approach to simplify calculation and also to relieve us from traditional estimates and statistical theory. So basically, this talk actually is intended to promote the use of information obtained directly from the data, so aligning with the conference theme. Okay, so firstly, I would like to go to the scope of my presentation. So I'll start with a bit of introduction on survival analysis. I'm sure most of you know what is survival analysis, but in case some of you are new to survival analysis, and then I'll move on to the objective of this research, like why I conducted this research, before moving on a bit only on the literature review. And then I'll talk a bit on the methodology. I'll also discuss about a simulation study that I conducted, and then a real data analysis on breast cancer patients before finally concluding with some conclusions, discussions, and future work. Okay, so let me start. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure all of you know by now, survival analysis is basically an analysis of lifetime data. So the main variable here is time. So the time can be time to death, time to diagnosis of a disease, time to failure of machines, or even time to end of marriages. So all this comes under survival analysis. An important component in survival analysis is censoring. Usually, lifetimes in survival analysis, they are right censored. That means they cannot be observed exactly. You can only observe them until a certain period, usually when the study ends or when the patient is suddenly lost up during follow-up, or suddenly they die due to other causes, not actually the cancer. This is also considered censored. And another important censoring in lifetime data analysis or survival analysis is known as interval censored. And this usually occurs in medical and biomedical studies where patients or subjects are only inspected periodically. Like, you know, doctors only meet patients every 3 months, every 2 months. So they cannot know the exact failure time, but they do know that the failure time occurred between 2 points. We call this the left endpoint, TLI, and the right endpoint, TRI. And another important factor in survival analysis are known as covariates. For those of you who are wondering what are covariates, they are actually something like your independent variable in regression. So they are basically other factors that affect survival time. So this can be your age, your gender, treatment time, and so on. Okay. And because of this censoring that happens in survival analysis, and there are also other kind of incomplete data in survival analysis, such as truncation, the data in survival analysis is usually non-normal and rather skewed, and usually right skewed. Thus, the traditional model checking methods needs adjustment, or even the model fitting needs adjustment. Okay. So the model advocacy study in survival data analysis usually uses the Cox-Snell and the modified Cox-Snell residual. The modified Cox-Snell residual is used because when data is right censored, you cannot use the ordinary Cox-Snell residual. You need to adjust for the excess in the residual. And traditionally, people are used to using traditional estimates as mean and median, which actually can fail with heavy censoring due to the skewed data and extreme values or outliers. So in this research, I'm proposing a technique based on the bootstrap. And the alternative bootstrap-based estimates and techniques is introduced by Efron and Tip Shirani. And they actually have been promising very good results when dealing with moderately censored data, you must use them wisely. And I've conducted quite a bit of research using Bootstrap. So this is a paper by me, and also Mika and Escobar has talked about this. And another important factor in survival analysis is because the data is skewed, sometimes the arithmetic mean doesn't work. So in this research, we are also going to incorporate the harmonic mean. Okay, you can also use the geometric mean, because both these means are known to deal better when data contains extreme values and outliers. So the objective of this research, so basically, first I look into incorporating covariates to survival models with right and interval sensor data. So I'll be talking about three models here. The first one is a new model, not really known to people. I call this the TBI model. This is a two-parameter model that accommodates both monotonically increasing and bathtub-shaped hazards. So it's very useful. And the other two models are quite well known in survival analysis. They are the extreme minimum value and the log likelihood distribution models. And what I'd like to do next is to obtain several modified residual for these models based on the Bootstrap bias corrected harmonic mean and a random imputation approach. I'll discuss about this later. And I would like to call this new residual H-boot. And thirdly, I would like to compare the performances of this newly proposed residual H-boot with the traditional Cox-Snell and the modified Cox-Snell residual at various censoring proportion and sample sizes. And finally, I would like to explore the model advocacy and also influence diagnostics for real data set from breast cancer study using these proposed methods and models. So just a bit on the literature review, not so much. So the TBI model is new, not many people know this, so I'm promoting this model. It was proposed by Chen, and it's very flexible, useful, because it accommodates both monotonic and non-monotonic or bathtub shape hazard rates. Okay, the other two models, log logistic and extreme minimum value distribution, is quite well known, so I'll just skip this part. And the CS residual, I spoken about this earlier, was introduced by Cox and Snell, and discussed by Collette. And it's widely used for assessing model fit in survival analysis. And I mentioned earlier, it only works when there is no censoring in the data. So when there's censoring in the data, you have to modify this residual. So Crowley and Hu actually introduced modification using the median instead of the mean. Okay. And recently, my student Niswa and Lai have actually showed that the modified CS residual for the Gompers distribution based on the empirical harmonic mean performs so much better than the CS and the modified CS residual. Another work by me and Professor Hafsha, also we have showed that the residual for the log logistic regression model based on the Bootstrap estimates perform better than traditional estimates. And I'm going to talk a bit on influence diagnostics. So just a bit, I would like to talk about this paper. There's a paper by me and my student Manoharan where we discuss the influence diagnostic for survival model with interval sensor data. There's very few research work that discusses influence diagnostic with interval sensor data. The reason also being, for example, in this model, we actually have a time-varying covariate. We have left truncation. We have interval sensor data. This is quite common in survival analysis. But when this happens, the likelihood derivation becomes very tedious and complex. It's many, many pages. And people avoid doing this kind of research. So when we were doing this work, I was thinking there must be an easier work to do this. That's when the idea came for this current research, where I realized we can use some computational approach to adjust for the residual and get almost the same results. Okay. So that is what led to the current research. So a bit on methodology. So as I said earlier, I'm going to incorporate covariate to the survival models. This can easily be done by any students, you know. So to incorporate covariates to the survival model, what you do is actually you choose a form. I usually choose the log linear form, and you incorporate into one of the parameters of the model. Usually we choose the scale parameter. Okay, so let x prime be the vector of covariate value. So you have more than one covariate, and beta prime be the unknown parameters. And if I let lambda, one of the parameters of the TBI model, to be equals to exponential minus beta prime x, this is known as the log linear form, the density and survival function for the new model, the TBIR model, R stands for regression. So the minute I accommodate a covariate, I call the model regression model, is given by expression one here. Okay, so I've just easily extended a model to incorporate covariates. Okay, and for the log likelihood and extreme minimum value models, because they are both log location scale models, I'm going to use this form of y is equals to log t, and z is y minus beta prime x over sigma. The density and survival functions are given by equation 2 and 3 respectively. So here, these parameters, lambda, gamma, and sigma are all greater than zero. And don't forget, we have another problem with this data. We have interval censoring. So let's say we let TLI and TRI be the left and right endpoints for the ith subject, where the subject is right censored if your TI is greater than TLI. And then we need an indicator variable because we have two types of data. So one is interval censored data. So if delta I is one, then TI is interval censored. If delta I is zero, then data is right censored. All this is for the programming part. So the log likelihood function for this full sample of TBR model with interval and right censored data is given by expression four. And for the log likelihood, log logistic and extreme minimum value regression models are given by expression 5 and 6 respectively. Okay, now we move on to the Coxnell residual. The Coxnell residual is actually equals to the estimated cumulative hazard, which is also the negative of the log estimated survival function respectively. So now we talk about how to modify this. So I already mentioned that when data is uncensored, you don't have any problem. You can just use the Coxnell residual. The problem happens when you have right censoring and interval censoring. When you have, I'll talk about right censoring first. When you have right censored data, there's an excess in the residual because right censored means the patient survives too long. So there is an excess also in the residual. So you need to accommodate this excess, which I call zeta, using a tactic. So people usually use traditional estimates such as the mean and median. So in this research, I'm proposing adjusting the Coxnell residual using the bootstrap bias corrected harmonic means. So for those of you familiar with the bootstrap technique, the bootstrap estimate of bias requires the sampling of a large number of B bootstrap samples with replacement from the original data set with equal probability. So you're using a lot of information from the data in hand, not some traditional estimate. And let H and H' be the sample harmonic means calculated using the original CS residual and the Bth bootstrap sample respectively, where your small b is just 1 to capital B. Then the estimate bootstrap bias is given by the following, okay, expression 7 here, where your S' is just the average of all these estimates, okay? You can choose any number of B, but people usually choose 800 to 1000. That is quite good already. Following that, you can actually get the bootstrap bias corrected estimates as given in expression 8. So this is the adjustment I want to make. And then the adjusted Coxnell residual when data is right censored is given by expression 9. So you see what I've done here is that the original residual I've added with this value. So I'm using this for the excess. So this is my new residual when data is right censored. But don't forget, we have another problem. We also have interval censored data. I need to adjust for that. So interval censored data, usually if you put this data into a software now, they will give you two residuals, one for the left point, one for the right point. Doesn't help you much. So here I'm proposing another technique using a random imputation method, which can be implemented using the following steps. So you people usually use midpoint imputation. Midpoint imputation only uses two points. So sometimes it's not that good, sometimes it works. Okay, here you're using a random imputation. So firstly, you generate R equals to 1000 random variates from the uniform distribution with left and right endpoint that are S hat TRI and S hat TLI for the ith observation. And S hat here is just the estimated survival function for the proposed model. Following that, you can transform each of these survival probabilities to obtain 1000 replication of each of their estimated lifetime. I denote this by TIR, where your R is from 1 to 1000 here, but you can use more if you want. Okay, following that, the estimated lifetime for the ith observation is given just by the average of all these R values. And then the adjusted Coxnell residual when data is interval censored is given by expression 10 here. So what I've done is I've used the TI' so that I just have one point, not two points. And now I can combine both this adjustment. So the new adjusted Coxnell residual when data is right and interval censored is given by expression 11 here. So I've done two adjustments here, okay? So Once we get the COX-9 residual, we can easily get another two residual that are well known in survival analysis, known as the martingale and the deviance residual. So just by adjusting the COX-9 residual, I can easily get the adjusted martingale and adjusted deviance residual, because the adjusted martingale residual depends on the COX-9 residual, and the adjusted deviance residual will depend on the adjusted martingale residual. So as given in expression 12 here. So can you see the adjusted martingale residual depends on the adjusted COX-9 residual, and the adjusted deviance residual depends on the adjusted martingale residual. Okay, and the plot of this residual versus the observation number is very effective at indicating poor pit and outliers. The plot versus the covariates can actually be used to check for patterns, possible extreme values, and outliers. Another important residual in survival analysis is known as the score or Schoenfeld residual. So here I'm also proposing getting the adjusted score residual, which is derived from the components of the likelihood equation, but here we are using the imputed lifetimes that I discussed about earlier. And once we get that, the plot of this adjusted score residual versus the observation number should be randomly distributed around zero for a good fit, and it is also very useful at indicating extreme observation and outliers. So let's go on to the simulation study now. I conducted a small simulation study with 1,000 replication at n equals to two sample sizes, 50 and 120, and approximate right sensitivity proportions of 30, 40, 50, 55, and 65% for all the three models I discussed earlier. And the right sensitivity time was simulated from the exponential distribution with parameter mu, where the mu can be adjusted to obtain the approximate right sensitivity proportion. Once you have that, you can easily generate interval sensor data by selecting appropriate intervals for the uncensored lifetimes from a sequence of kappa equals to 24 checkup times at 2 months interval. You can, of course, play around with this. Okay, and then we want to analyze three residuals. The first one is the new residual proposed by me, H. Boot. Second one is the traditional COX-9 residual with midpoint imputation, because this is the most popularly used technique now. And the third one is the modified COX-9 residual with midpoint imputation. And the parameters for all the three models, these were the values that I chose. And basically the reason I chose these values is simply to mimic real cancer data measured in months. You can of course choose other values, but usually when you do simulation, you want to choose values that mimic real data, okay? And then to access the result, we can use the following plot, which should be a straight line with unit slope. That means slope equals to 1 and 0 intercept if the residuals are performing well at indicating model adequacy. Okay, so because of that, we can use the mean absolute deviation value of the intercept slope and coefficient of correlation R from the desired value of 0, 1, and 1 respectively. Okay, so these are the results. Okay, so this gives the MAD value for the log logistic model. And the first one is for the intercept, slope, and R. These are all the MAD values. So the closer it is to zero, the better. So the straight line here is for H-Booth. The dashed line is for the modified COX-9. And the dotted line is for COX-9. So you can see very clearly here for all the three graphs here, the MAD for the H-Booth is the lowest. Similarly, for sample size 120, this is for the LLR model. And for the extreme minimum value model, the pattern is the same. Okay, and for the new model TBIR, generally it is the same, although not very consistent, but generally it is still the lowest. So our conclusion here will be that the H-Booth, which is the new residual that I propose, generally gives a much lower MAD values for the intercept, slope, and R at all levels of censoring proportions and sample sizes. The modified CS performs slightly better than the CS, but however, the H-Booth clearly outperforms both this residual at indicating a good model fit. So now that we are quite satisfied that it performs well, we move on to the real data analysis. So the real data analysis I'm carrying out with 94 breast cancer patients. This is a data from Finkelstein and Wolf. Here, patients were given, these are 94 breast cancer patients, they were given two therapies, treatments. One is only the radiation therapy, I call this RT. And the second one is the radiation therapy plus chemotherapy, I call this RCT. We want to see which one is better. And this data has 61 and 39% patients that are interval and right censored. Okay, so in line with my research, we have interval and right censored observations only. Okay, and when I analyze this data, two models fits the data really well, the extreme minimum value model and the TBIR model. But I chose to analyze the data using the TBIR model because it is a new model and I would like to explore this model more. So I fit the data using the TBIR model. Okay, so figure 7 shows the Turnbull non-parametric estimate and the TBIR survival function estimates for the cancer data. So on the left here, you can see the data for the patients that received RCT treatment. On the right are data for the patients who received RT treatment. First, what you observe is that the model fits the data quite well. Secondly, what you notice is that the RT group, that means the group that only received radiation therapy, they survive longer compared to the group that received radiation plus chemotherapy. I think this is quite a well-known fact in cancer studies. Huh? Sometimes chemo doesn't really help you much. Radiation helps you better. Okay. And table 1 gives the parameter estimates when the TBIR model was fit to the breast cancer data. What is very noticeable here is that if you observe the confidence interval here, the wall confidence interval, and the p-value for parameter beta 1, what you notice is that there is a significant treatment effect because the p-value is 0. And we can also observe this using figure 8. So the figure A here shows the estimated hazard for the two groups. The straight line is for those who receive RT treatment, the radiotherapy, and the dashed line is for those who received RCT treatment. So hazard is like failure. Hazard rate is failure rate. So you can see that the RT group, they have a lower hazard rate. And on the right-hand side, it gives the survival probability. So they have a higher survival probability. Okay, and the RCT, they have a lower survival probability. And if you look at the median survival time for RT and RCT groups, the RT, they survive, the median survival time is 39.6. This is the median. Eh? This is not the survival time. This is the median survival time, like your mean. It's 39.6. And the median survival time for the RCT group is only 23.3 months. This is a ratio of almost 1.7. And the hazard ratio of the RCT group to the RT group at any time is 2.60. which actually means the RCT group is failing at a rate of 2.6 times that of the RT group. Okay, so figure 9 shows the index plot of the HBOOT residual, the new residual proposed by me, which actually shows clearly that the TBIR model fits the data very well because you have a straight line, you have the intercept, which is 0, and you have the slope, which is very close to 1. And figure 10 shows the adjusted Martingale residual. And what you notice is that it indicates there could be a potential outlier, which is patient 94. So patient 94, if you analyze, this patient had a failure time that is greater than 48 months. It's right censored at 48 months. Right censored means it didn't fail at 48 months. The patient was still not showing any symptoms of the disease at 48 months. That means they survive longer than 48 months. So this is actually much larger than other patients who receive RCT treatment. If you recall, the median for RCT treatment was 23.3. So when the patient has more than 48 months, that is quite long. And this is why probably it was identified as a potential outlier. And figure 11 shows the adjusted deviance residual. The outlying effect of observation 94 is not very apparent here. You can see it is this observation here, slightly lower than the others. Okay. The first graph is versus observation number. The second graph here is versus treatment. Okay. So this is actually because the deviance residual are more symmetrically distributed around zero if an app model has been fit to data. So you cannot see the effect so much. So you need to investigate further. So now let's look at the score residual. Similarly, the score residual also singles out observation 94, just slightly higher than the other residual. Okay, so there is an issue of being outlying observation and influential observation. So for those of you who do conduct analysis or outlier, you know these two things are different. So I'm going to talk a bit on the influence diagnostic. So I'm using three measures here. The first one is the case deletion diagnostics, DF-beta, or DF-betas, which is just the standardized DF-beta. And the plot of DF-betas for each of the parameter in the model can then be used to detect influential observation. The second one, I'm using the measure of curvature introduced by Cook. And most of you know that the maximum curvature is the, just the maximum eigenvalue of f double dot with the corresponding eigenvector d max. And we know that large elements of d max would actually indicate potentially influential observation. And the third method I am going to use is the index plot of half of this f double dot ii. And this f double dot ii is just the diagonal element of f double dot. And this index plot can be used to detect overall influence on the estimates. So figure 13 shows the index plot of half f double dot ii, A here, and absolute value of D max, B. So you can see it shows observation 61 and 94 as being potentially influential. Observation 94, you already know why, because I told you they have a very large survival time. Observation 61 or patient 61 also receive RCT treatment, and they are interval censored at between 44 to 48. So they are not right censored. That means they fail between 44 to 48 months. So this is the second largest interval censored lifetime under RCT treatment. This is why it was identified as being potentially influential. But you can see the effect is not as great as observation 94. So we cannot simply remove or something. We need to investigate. Okay. And the figure 14 shows the DF betas for treatment. This is the A here. And for parameter gamma, B. So for the first graph, you can see it also indicates observation 94 as being potentially influential. But the plot for DF betas for parameter gamma actually identifies more observation, 3, 10, 33, and 63, including 94 as being potentially influential. So what we can easily observe here is that the single case perturbation mainly affects the parameter gamma, okay, not the treatment parameter. Okay, so now what I'm going to do is remove the most influential observation, because I'm not very fond of simply removing observation. Okay, so since observation 94 was identified by all the graphs, so let's remove it and see what happens. And what happens is that the median time ratio for the RT group to the RCT group increases from 1.7 to 1.77, quite a substantial increase. And the estimated hazard ratio for the RCT group to RT group changes from 2.6 to 2.9, which is close to 3. Okay, so I would not advise to simply remove other observations just because they are identified as being influential, because I believe they still carry valuable information regarding the treatment administered. For example, observation 3, 10, 63, and 33, they are all receiving RCT treatment and they have very low failure times. That's why they're influential. But they actually tell us some patients can have failure time lesser than 5 months or 8 months. And this is information you want to know. Okay. So that's, we have come to the conclusion of my research. So the conclusion is that the residual based on the bias corrected bootstrap estimates and random imputation works better than traditional residuals when data is right and interval censored. And the proposed technique requires far lesser time and effort. It avoids tedious and lengthy likelihood contributions. Seriously, this method is quite easy for me compared to deriving lengthy likelihood functions. And these techniques are practical in assessing survival model adequacy, identifying potential outliers and influential observation. And the current work actually has a lot of potential. You can extend this to survival models with time-dependent covariate, truncated data and bivariate models or parallel system models where the likelihood derivations are actually very tedious. Okay, and we can also extend the work to explore other kinds of means, like the geometric means. You know, not always your arithmetic mean works the best. You know, your geometric mean sometimes works better. So you can explore bias-corrected geometric means and probably even explore bias-corrected double bootstrap estimates or even jackknife estimates, all these computational techniques that depend solely on the data in hand. Okay, so that's about all for my presentation. And so I'll hand it back to the moderator for the next session. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Arason, for sharing the interesting topic. This I can see that quite a lot of work on this topic. My apologies that I forgot to mention that you did the PSC in survival analysis in University of Oxford, United Kingdom in 2006.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes, before going to the question and answer sessions, we are now, I'm in fact the second speaker. So the second speaker is Dr. Bagus Sartono. He is my senior in Department of Statistics, IPB University. Hello, Pak Bagus. Are you there?
Yes, Bu Tami. Hello.
Hello. Okay. Then in the Romanian, I will call him Pak Bagus. His expertise on design of experiments, statistical modeling, machine learning, interpretable machine learning, and exploratory data analysis. And he has also graduated from Applied Economics, UNREP University, Belgium. Today, he will talk about ensemble approach to determining variable important for interpreting machine learning model. So, Pak Bagus, screen is yours.
Thank you very much, Bu Tami. Good day, everybody. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. My screen is already on, Bu Tami.
Yes, Pak. Yes.
Okay. Okay, thank you very much for the conference committee, especially Dr. Fitrianto, who invited me to give a presentation today. And of course, thank you for Ibu Tami Savitri, who conduct this session. What I would like to present is about the ensemble approach to determining variable importance in the interpretable machine learning. This is the work together with Dr. Alfian Futul Hadi from Jember University and Dr. Evi Ramadhani from University of Syekh Kuala Aceh. What I would like to share today is first, I will talk about the motivation of this research, and then I will go briefly about what is the permutation variable importance and why it is important and what is our research problem. And then I will continue with our proposed method in implementing genetic algorithm approach to find the optimal order of the variable importance. And we will have some small illustration in the data of food insecurity problem in Indonesia. And I will conclude the talk with a general discussion. Here's the first motivation. As we know, today machine learning is becoming a favorite approach done by statisticians, data scientists across the world, across different areas, because machine learning promises us to have a model with very high accuracy in prediction. Gerard James, Trevor Hestie et al. In their books provide this kind of summary. The accuracy, interpretability of the model. Linear model is a very common model used by statisticians, and it is very easy to interpret the model, but the problem is this kind of model usually has a very low accuracy, especially if the relationship between the predictor and the response variables are not linear. On the other hand, the one or the model with the neural network, boosted tree, random forest, support vector machine, is very easy to find a model with a very high accuracy, but it's difficult to interpret. In fact, in the many applications, there is a higher demand of how to explain the model. So then people move to what they call the interpretable machine learning. The two questions that always arise when we have a machine learning model is first, how is the relationship between the predictor variables and the response variable? It is negative or positive relations or linear, non-linear, and so on. And another question is about if we have many, many variables, many, many large number of predictor variables, we always want to know which variable do have large contribution compared to the other variable. So these two questions always come after we have a model, especially with the machine learning model, because it is not easy to answer this question. If you have a linear model, including survival model that Professor Jayanti shared to us, it will be quite easy, because we can see the value of the coefficient, the beta values, and based on that beta values, we can see it is negative or positive, it is a small or a large value. So we can answer this question not very hard. But if we have neural network approach that what Professor Kim discussed with us this morning, it is quite hard to answer these two questions. So one of the way to answer that question is about measuring the importance of the variable. So the basic idea is, if we want to tell that whether a variable is important or not, is by looking at the prediction error. If we remove these variables and the prediction error is increasing significantly, then we will conclude that this variable is important. But it is not easy to remove the variables if the model is already exists. So what we can do, some of people introduce what they call the permutation variable importance. Permutation variable importance basically is comparing the prediction error of the model when the variable is used originally. So we use the original arrangement of the data, and if the variable is shuffled, if we randomize the position or we permuted the position of the variable. So this is the visual explanation about the permutation variable. For example, we have already the machine learning model, and then we would like to know which variable is important or which variable is not. So let us start with the X1. If we look at, or we would like to examine the importance of the X1, we use the original data and then fit the original data to the machine learning model, and we will have the prediction, compare this prediction to the actual or the original value of the response variable, and we will have the error. Okay, and then we shuffle the row of the X1. You can see that now we have new data, synthetic data, where all of the X column, X2 to X5, is the same or identical as the previous one. But for the column of X1, we shuffle we permuted the row of this column. And then with this kind of arrangement, we plug in this data into the machine learning model, and we got the second prediction based on this data set. And then we have the second error. The variable important is basically is the increasing of the second error compared to the first error. So a feature or of a variable predictors is important if the shuffling resulted with the large value of the increases in the error. If the error is remain the same, I mean there is no significant change between error 2 and error 1, then we say that the x1 is not important. So this is what we can see in the originally suggested by Bremen and in 2001, and then extended by Fisher, Rudin, and Dominici in 2018. These two books, the books by Christoph Molnar and Bursikovsky, explain this kind of approach in very detail. For you want to find complete explanation about this approach, I think you can find in these two books. Okay, so when we implement this approach in our case study data set, the data set is about the food insecurity experience scale in the national survey of social and economics in the province of West Java in Indonesia. So this is one of biggest province in Indonesia. The number of respondents is around 25,000 households. And then we implement the machine learning model with four different algorithms: random forest, extreme gradient boosting, neural network, and support vector machine. We have 24 predictors, 24 variables exist in the model, and the response is the whether the household is experiencing food insecurity or not. And then this is the result of the permutation variable importance. And this is the problem when we have this kind of result. You can see we have 24 predictors, and with the permutation variable importance based on the four models that we obtain from extreme gradient boosting, random forest, neural network, and support vector machine, we have different order of the importance of the variable. See, for example, when we use the extreme gradient boosting, this is the order or the rank of the variable importance of these predictors. And this is when we have the random forest. It's not of very much different, but we can see that the order of the, let's say, 10 best or 10 most important variable is not a very high correlation, especially if you see the result by support vector machine. So what is the problem of this research is actually, can we generate a final rank of the predictors? So the final rank will have the high correlation with the other result of the machine learning algorithm. So if we formulate the mathematical notation of this problem, suppose that we have n different number of the machine learning algorithms. So we have, it's like n columns of the variable importance, and then we have p predictors. In our cases, previously p is 24 and n is 4, and then we have matrix of s is p by n of variable important measurement score. So this is basically the s. If we remove the rank, so this is the s matrix. And then what we would like to find is like to obtain a factor of R containing the final rank of variable importance, but we have R should have a maximum correlation to each of the column of S. So this is the mathematical problem. And because it is an optimization problem, and you can say that because the order or the rank is is the integer value 1, 2, 3 up to 24, then we can see it is a combinatorial optimization problem. And we propose then to use the genetic algorithm to find the solution, to find the optimum R first by generating the population and by defining the chromosome as the chromosome with the 24 genes. 24 is the number of the predictors. The value of gene is the permutation of 1 up to 24. And then each of the genes value is representing the rank of the variables. So then after we have the population of the chromosomes, then we do the selection process. What we mean with the selection process is we select several base chromosome which has maximum value of minimum correlation. So we maximize the minimum correlation between R and the column of S. Okay, and then after the selection process, it is the very generic algorithm of the genetic algorithm. We continue with the crossover and mutation process. And then if it is convergence, then we stop. But if it is not convergence to the specific solution, then we back to the selection process. Refine the solution by the crossover mechanism, and then the iteration is going and going until we have the best solution that we can produce by the genetic algorithm. So let me illustrate how this algorithm is going. So this is, for example, the population of the chromosome. Let's see, this is the chromosome number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And its chromosome is just the permutation of the number 1 up to 24. So imagine that the chromosome number 1 say that the predictor number 1 is on the position of number 17, predictor number 2 at the 6th position, predictor number 3 at 18th position, and so on. And because we have already the S matrix, then we can calculate the correlation between this chromosome, this solution, to the S matrix. So if we calculate the correlation, then the first chromosome have the correlation of 0.177 to the variable important of extreme gradient boosting, 0.256 to random forest variable importance, and so on. And the objective value is the minimum of these four values, and it is 0.177. The same thing can we can do for the chromosome number 2, 3, 4, and 5. And based off this one, because we want to maximize the objective value, then we select the two best solution. So solution number 1 and number 5 is the best among these five chromosomes. And then we select this as the best chromosome. And then we continue with the crossover mechanism. So the crossover mechanism is just by combining the first part of the chromosome number 1 and the second part of the chromosome number 5. So it's like we split the chromosome number 1 and 5 into two parts, and then we combine by the crossover mechanism. So this is the new spring or the new chart of the result. So you can see that the beginning genes of the chromosome is from the chromosome number 1, and the end part of the is the end part of the chromosome number 5. The same thing we can do by putting the first part from the chromosome number 5 and the end part is from the chromosome number 1. Okay, so this is the two spring by crossover mechanism, and then we recode the order, because you can see, for example, in the spring number one, there is two gene with the five rank. So the rank is five, is there is a two, and then we recode by adding a small random value, and then we have this arrangement. And the process is going on up to we have the improvement of the solution. The typical result that we have with a very bad solution, and in every iteration we improve the solution by the genetic algorithm process, and going up and so on. And what usually it is converged at the 20 or 25 iteration. So after 20 or 25 iteration, we see that it's already find the best solution that can be had by the genetic algorithm. And for the our case, this is the result. So I copied the rank of the variable importance based on the four machine learning algorithm that I show you already before, and then the most right column is the result generated by the genetic algorithm, and we can see that the most important predictor for the food insecurity experience in the household is the education of the family head. And the number two is the whether of or not the family member have a saving account in bank. So now, by looking at the yellow column of this slide, we can see that this is the final order that we propose or we can provide to the decision maker about which predictor is important. And if we evaluate the solution by looking at the correlation between our result to the four original machine learning algorithm, it is quite good. You can see that the correlation is very high. All of them are above 9.92. So we can see that the result is very satisfying. Okay, so let me conclude what we have. First, that the genetic algorithm that we propose is useful for us to find the optimal order of the variable importance. If you have, for example, if you have 4, 5, or 6, or whatever the number of machine learning algorithm that you implement to your data, and then you run the permutation variable importance, you will have varying order of the variable importance based on those algorithms. Then you can combine the ranks into one using this kind of optimization approach. Of course, what we did is using the minimum correlation to be maximized in this paper or in this research. We can change the objective function to be minimized by the algorithm. For example, we can have the average of correlation, or if it is a large number of machine learning algorithm, you may have a median of the correlation or other summarizing value. And of the challenge is in several cases that we have, there are larger number of predictors. What I show you in this slides is there are only 24 predictors, but in the other cases, you may have 100, you may have 200 or even 1,000 predictors. So of course it will be increase the challenge to solve the problem. We may have, or we may try another meta-heuristic approach, such as simulated annealing or cuckoo search, which in the literature, this kind of approach may have faster or better speed in finding the solution. And the other one is to increase the speed of the algorithm, we can also have a systematic initial population instead of random chromosome that we already done. We can also change it into the systematic initial population, so the number of iteration will be much lesser. I think that's the end of the presentation, and I would like to thanks to all the team who support this research, especially the student from the IPB University, University of Jember, and University of Syekh Kuala. Also, we would like to thanks to Badan Riset and Inovasi Nasional, or Agency of Research and Innovation of Republic of Indonesia, who provide us a research grant for this research. Thank you very much for your attention, and I give back the time to moderator Utami. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pak Bagus, for the interesting and ongoing research. I can also see that your research is also quite a lot of things to do, similar with Professor Arasan did. Last but not least, I invite the third speaker of this session, Dr. Aswi. Hello, Dr. Aswi, are you there?
Yes, thank you, Guta.
Okay, yes. Dr. Aswi will talk about comparison of Bayesian spatial models on a small number of areas. She is a lecturer at Mathematics and Statistics at the University of Makassar, Indonesia. Makassar is in South Sulawesi, so this is in on another island from I am now. Yeah, thank you, Bu Aswi, for joining. His research now is related to statistics, basically in public health related to dengue fever. So, Bu Aswi, time is yours.
Thank you, Bu Utami. Yeah, let me share my screen first.
Yes, please.
Okay, can you hear my voice, Bu Utami?
Yes, yes, Bu Asi, I can hear.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. First, I would like to thanks the committee for inviting me as one of the invited speakers to this conference. Today, I'm going to talk about my research, comparison of Bayesian spatial models on a small number of areas. This talk consists of three parts. The first is a simulation study that consider count data aggregated to a small area level. The second one is a case study on dengue fever in Makassar, Indonesia. And the third is a case study on COVID-19 cases in Makassar, Indonesia. So the first two parts, based on this paper, which has been published in the International Journal of Health Geographics entitled Evaluating the Impact of a Small Number of Areas on Spatial Estimation, collaboration with Susanna Prem, L. Duncan, and Kerry Meyerson from Queensland University of Technology Australia. Spatial models are widely used in many fields. A common application is disease mapping, where typically the region is partitioned into neighboring small areas to estimate the overall spatial pattern of disease incident or disease risk. Bayesian hierarchical models are commonly used when there is a linear predictor and spatial random effect that describe the residual spatial autocorrelation model. And commonly, spatial random effects are often represented by a conditional autoregressive or card prior. So this is the concept of autoregressive card prior, that value of spatial random effect ui in the I area depends on its neighbors, and value is normally distributed with mean given by the average of its neighbors, and variance is inversely proportional to the number of neighbors. So we define omega ij equals 1 if I and j areas are adjacent, otherwise equals 0. So for example, area 8 here, it has 3 neighbors, namely 4, 7, and 9. So omega 8, 7, omega 8, 4, and omega 8, 9 equals 1, and others equals 0. So a range of card prior has been proposed, such as BYM model. So BYM model allows for spatial and unstructured area level variation, and it consists of two components, namely UI and VI. And UI has card prior, and this VI has normal prior. And the second one is Leroux model. It also allows for spatial and unstructured area level variation, but it consists only of one component, namely UI, and is defined as normally distributed with this mean and this variance. So UI has combined a CAR and normal prior. So when rho equals 1, we have an intrinsic CAR, while when we have rho equals 0, we have an independent model. Previous studies have compared different Bayesian spatial models. For example, one research compared BYM mixture models, non-parametric smoothing method. One research also have compared BYM Leroux and Cressy priors, and another research have compared BYM Leroux and locally adaptive models. But a common feature is a relatively large number of areas ranging from 170 to 271. However, there is a growing number of studies that employ spatial models of regions with a relatively small number of areas. So why is small number of areas important? Estimation of the risk in any area depends on neighboring areas, then the number of areas may influence spatial estimation. Also, the number of neighbors determines the variance of card prior, and it may influence the smoothing or estimation of spatial models. So the aim of this talk is to compare the relative performance of Bayesian spatial models when there are few areas through a simulation study, a case study involving dengue fever in Makassar, Indonesia, and the third, a new work, is a case study involving COVID-19 cases in Makassar, Indonesia. So our simulation study actually considering a Poisson distributed response, we use three forms of spatial CAR priors, namely BYM, Leroux, and localized and an independent prior. There are 32 different scenarios, 2 different degrees of spatial autocorrelation, high and low spatial autocorrelation, two different intercept, high and low counts, eight different number of regular aerial grids from 2x2, 3x3 until 50x50 or 25,100 areas with 15 replication for each model. So this resulted in a total of 1900 data sets. So the example of the regular aerial grid is this is the example 2x2 or 4 areas. And this is for 9 areas and 16 areas. So the size of every aerial grid is 1. The procedure to generate the synthetic data here is the first one is create artificial shape file. The second one is compute centroids. The third one is generate data. And then the fourth one is create model using input data, centroid and shapefile, and using carbide score to use these four kinds of Bayesian models, namely BYM, Leroux, localized, and independent model. So before that, the convergence of each model parameter was checked through the GWK diagnostic and density plot. So from that, we get the output of each model, and the last, we fit the measure of this model. So as I mentioned before, there are four different Bayesian spatial models within CarPies we use in this simulation study, namely independent, BYM, Leroux, localized model with G equals 2, and localized model with G equals 3. So the BYM and Leroux I already explained before, and so I will focus on independent and localized model. So independent model here is there is no spatial autocorrelation. So yi is distributed Poisson with mu ei times theta I, where log theta i equals alpha plus phi. So phi here is the spatially unstructured random effect, while yi is the number of disease event, in this case, dengue fever and COVID-19 cases. And ei here is the expected number of cases, and theta I is the relative risk. And localized model here is the same with a Leroux model, but there is an additional lambda components for grouping structure. So it's allowed to have a more a group structure in this model. So this is the example result for simulated dataset for 100 areas or 10x10 areas under different scenarios. So point I is low spatial autocorrelation and low counts. B is high spatial autocorrelation and low counts. So we can look at here that A and C exhibit spatial independence on randomness. And B and D here shows that values of similar magnitude were clustered together, indicating that there is a positive spatial autocorrelation. So this is a modified Moran's I estimate for simulated count data. So I don't use Moran's I here because there is research that state that Moran's I can underestimate for a small number of area. So they use modified Moran's I or MMI. Yeah, so in this case, we use MMI. MMI as a measure of spatial autocorrelation performed poorly when there are very small areas, for example, 2x2, but tends to capture especially high spatial autocorrelation, even when the number of area is relatively small. For example, here is 3x3, this is 3x3, 4x4, 5x5, and so on. But MMI estimates for low autocorrelation here, close to zero, this one close to zero, and while MMI estimate for high autocorrelation is close to one. So this is one. For comparing the models, all models were analyzed using CAR-based package in software R. The posterior distribution for the parameter is obtained by MC-MC algorithm. The goodness of fit of the model was compared using WAIC, and the smaller value of WAIC indicates a better model fit. So the result overall, based on the mean WAIC, when areas had low autocorrelation and high counts, model performs differently for all number of areas. But when the number of areas is at most 5 by 5 or 25 areas, the BYM, LeRoux, and localized G equals two models often perform similarly but noticeable better than independent and localized G equals three models. When the number of areas at least were at least 10 by 10 or 100 areas, all models perform differently, but with the LeRoux model having the best goodness of fit based on WAIC. So overall, our simulation study showed that the LeRoux model performed well for all models under every simulated scenario, especially when there are at least 16 areas. This result is in agreement with another study with 271 areas that reported the LeRoux model was preferred when compared against BYM and CRACI models. So let's move on to the case study first. Case study one is a dengue fever incident in Makassar, Indonesia. I just choose this certain years, 2002, 2010, 2011, 13, and 15. So we choose these years actually as there is substantial variation both within and between years, with the mean and variance of dengue fever in 2002 much higher than other years. And the raw standardized incidence rates can be used to obtain the disease risk estimates, and is defined as the ratio of the observed number of dengue cases, YI, to the expected number of dengue in each area, EI. So SIR here is YI over EI, where expected number of cases is calculated by a sigma YI over sigma NI times NI, where NI here is the number area I. So when we have SIR more than a one, it indicates high risk. This is the raw SIR maps for 5 time periods. So we can see here that the red one has highest SIR. So here is Rappaccini district has the highest SIR, and also here in 2010, 2011, but in 2013, the highest SIR is from Manggala districts. So the WAIC of dengue cases for 5 models, from independent BYM LeRoux localized model, we can see here BYM LeRoux localized with G equals 2 and localized with G equals 3. So we can see that in 2002, independent BYM and LeRoux model perform similarly, but differ from localized case. So here is very similar, but localized model is better. And for 2010, BYM and LeRoux also very similar, but here localized G equals 2 is the best. And 2011, the BYM models is the lowest WAC, while in 2015, the performance of BYM LeRoux localized G equals 2 and localized G equals 3 are similar. So we can look at here in the red signal. So this is the explanation. So in 2002, the localized model with G equals 3 performed better than localized model with G equals 2. The BYM independent and LeRoux model are very similar. Maybe it's because the raw for LeRoux model in 2002 was 0.08, indicating that there was very little spatial smoothing. In 2010, BOM and Neural model performed similarly but differ from localized and independent model. But in this year, localized model with g equals 3 are similar, are the best. So interestingly, that as I mentioned before, that dengue data in 2015 had similar descriptive statistics, which is the observed means was 10 with the simulated data for high count. So in our simulated data for high counts has mean about 10, and we can conclude that the result is really similar with the simulation study, which is BYM, Leroux, localized G equals 2 and localized G equals 3 models were similar fit and provide better fit than independent model. So this is the localized structure for localized model with G equals 2 and G equals 3. So the localized V equals G equals 2 for 2011 only consists of one group, and also for G equals 3 consists only of one group. However, for 2013, when we have we set up localized structure, localized model with G equals 2, it has two groups, namely the group 1 and the group 2. And when we have localized with G equals 3, we have also three groups, namely the first group is Kalo, and the second group is called 2, and the last group is 3, namely Mangala, which is has the higher relative risk, namely 2.08. So it seems that the number of dengue cases, the variance, and any outliers influence the number of groups as seen in 2002 and 2013. In 2002, one area, namely Rapocini District, formed its own group because it has SIR more than 2. And also in 2013, one area, Mangala District, formed its own group because it has SIR more than 2. So the limitation of this study is that the simulated data might have been influenced by the neighborhood structure. The real boundaries generated do not exhibit a grid style structure, but instead define areas that vary in size, shape, and number of neighbors. And our simulation study results are limited by not having a relatively large contrast in the magnitude and variation on counts over areas, as seen in the case study in Sentai's area, as I explained before. So the case study two is COVID-19 cases in Makassar, Indonesia. So we use the number of confirmed cases of COVID-19 from 19 March 2020 to 30 August 2021 for each district. We obtained from the official website of Makassar Health Office, and also we use population data from Badan Pusat Statistik. So the research focus in Makassar City, we have actually in 2020-2021, it has 15 districts, while in 2017, it's only 14 districts. So this is the result of DIC and WIC of COVID-19 cases. We can see here that the best model to model the COVID-19 cases is localized model followed by Leroux model. So based on the best model, for localized model with G equals 2 and G equals 3, we can see here but that the lowest, the group one is Sangkarang, which it has the lowest relative risk 0.09. And then here, we have for car localized model with G equals 3, we also have this one as group one, and another one, it has two and three. So it consists, they have one group for, we call three here, and then the other one, the same group with called two. So this is the localized structure. So based on this is the map of car localized model. We can see that one group is consists of one area, which is the Sangkarang Island, and the other group consists of 14 areas. And the second one for model G equal 3, we have a group one consists of one group, and the second one is consists of 1, 2, 3, 4 groups, and the remainder is the group three. So this is the relative prisma. So we can see here that this area is ujung pandang has the highest relative risk, which is about 1.7. So the relative risk of ujung pandang is 1.7. So we conclude that based on the case study, the comparative performance of spatial models may vary for a small number of areas, especially when the data have a relatively large mean and variance over areas. In this case, the localist model is preferred. Detecting spatial pattern can be difficult when there are very few areas. So understanding the characteristic of data and the relative influence of alternative conditional autoregressive priors is essential in selecting an appropriate Bayesian spatial models. So this I like to acknowledge the co-authors of this paper, distinguished Prof. Kerry Manderson, Susanna, the IRC, ASEMS in Australia, and the University Negeri Makassar. So this is the reference. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you, Dr. Asmi, for nice and very interesting research. I also would like to ask apologies that I forgot to mention that you did your PhD in Bayesian statistics, in Queensland University. Yes. Okay, I know Professor Kerry very well because before I did the PhD, I applied scholarship, but this difference failed now. Okay, now we are going to the question and answer sessions. I invite all of you to ask the questions to the three speakers. Please mention to who addressed the questions. You can click raise hand emoticon in Zoom, or you can write the question in the chat room. Because the session is also live in YouTube, I also invite the audience in YouTube to write the question in chat room. Who asked? Please raise your hand. Is there anyone? So who will ask this very interesting topics this afternoon? I enjoyed the talk very much. Okay. Maybe I will ask first to Professor Arasan. Yes. During you did your research that you did with the small number of sample, 50, and the large number of 20 sample, 120. Is the sample size sensitive in your methodology?
Yeah, definitely. Because actually, when the sample size in survival data is small, when you have right censoring and interval censoring, what happens is the information you have is very limited. So when sample size is small, that means limited information. And when you have censored observation, more limitation. So, and these methods that I propose, they are actually very good when sample size is moderate, like 50, 60. When the sample size increases, if you notice my graph, the traditional methods start to work quite well also. So actually, these kind of new methods that I propose, they're very useful when sample size is not that large. Because, you know, according to asymptotic theory as well, when sample size is large, everything works quite well. So we have problem when you have moderate sample size. This is why I chose 50, 120. But of course, you can try other sample sizes. So especially in survival analysis, it's very sensitive to sample size. And especially if you're using the bootstrap technique, it is very sensitive to sample size when you have censoring. It will not work if your sample size, for example, is 20. If you have 20 and you have right censoring, bootstrap will usually fail. So you need to have moderate sample size. Thank you. That's a wonderful question, actually.
You're welcome, Professor. So the important things, if you did the survival analysis, you have to consider the sample size.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Okay. Thank you, Professor Rasan. Okay, this questions, then this one, participant hand raise. Please, Pak Mupis. Yes. Still mute. Wait a minute. Okay, please, the time.
Thank you for the opportunity. My name is Mukhlis Ardiansyah. I'm a student of IBB University. My question is addressed to Pak Bagus. Thanks for the great presentation. It can be seen from the results table that the last column, namely the rank of the variable that has the highest influence rating, is the average ranking of the four models. Then salted from the minimum. My question is, why the four models are given the same weight? Because according to the background that compare the model interpretable between accuracy level, there is a difference in the level of accuracy between the models of or the methods. Why the weight is the same? Okay. Thank you.
Okay, please, Pak Bagus. But maybe before you answer the question of Mupis, maybe you can explain a little bit what is the four kind difference model that you use. Please.
Okay. Thank you very much for the question. So basically, if we run a different algorithm of machine learning, then we will have a different models. But the problem is we cannot see the form of the models because I think all of you know that the machine learning model is similar to non-parametric model in statistics that we cannot explicitly wrote the form of the models. So because of we cannot see the model, then we try to interpret the model by looking at the variable importance. You are correct, Pak Mukhlis, that every models that we have, the four models that we have, have a different accuracy level. And the question is, why not we put the accuracy as the weight of the rank for the final order? First of all, that accuracy is the only one. Not the only one. I mean, accuracy is not the only one measurement to the quality of the models. So there are many other many other metrics that we can use to measure the quality of the model. So if we rely on the accuracy, then perhaps there will be another question. Why not use another metrics to give the weight? So in that reason, we not use any weight, any measurement to weight the result from the machine learning. So it's like, okay, this is, we have a four model and it has the same weight. I think that's the explanation of what we did, Pak Mukhlis. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Pak Bagus.
Thank you, Pak Bagus. Pak Mukhlis, is enough or you would like to ask a question again?
Yeah, it's enough.
Okay, thank you, Pak Mukhlis. So this questions in the chat room to Bu Aswi from Bu Ayumin Sofro. I think she is a lecturer at University State of Surabaya. Will you ask directly or I will read your question. Okay, I will read the question. I think I will read because there's two questions to Bu Aswi. First of all, from Bu Ayunin. Yeah, Bu Aswi, what is the reason analyzing dengue fever every year? Well, from the second application in COVID data, you use data start from 2020 to 2021.
Yes. Thank you very much for the question from Ayunin Sofra. So actually, for dengue, for COVID-19 data, we only have the COVID-19 data start from 19 March 2020. And when I analyze this data, it is the last data is 30 of August. So that is why I aggregated the data from the number of confirmed cases of COVID-19 from 19 March 2020 to 30 August 2021. So why I use many, it's not actually every year for the dengue data, but I only use 2002, 2010, 2011, 2013, and 2015. The reason for choosing this year is actually because there is a substantial variation both within and between years. So we can see if I don't need to share the screen. You can see that in 2002, there is a lot of variation with 10,620, and in 2013 the variation also quite big, but in 2015 the variance and the mean of dengue cases is quite similar. So that is why I need to compare this. What happened when I have a mean and variation a little big, and what happened when I have a mean and variation which is relatively similar to the simulation data. So that's the idea of why I choose these areas. So we can conclude that we can see in 2015 that when the dengue cases is relatively small and also the variance is relatively small, so the performance of four Bayesian spatial models are similar in terms of the WIIC. And also for localized model, even when we set with G and G equals 3, it consists only of one group when the mean, the cases, and the variance is relatively small. That's. And the second one, can I directly read Bu Utami?
There's another question from Pak Maskur, Muhammad Maskur. Yes, could the model be applied to the point pattern on area or aerial spatial data?
Yeah, so this model actually, my focus is actually for aerial data. So it is the aerial data, and it is could also be applied to point data. So there is a combination with point data and aerial data, and we can see one book entitled Geospatial Health Data with the co-author of this is Paula Moraga. There is an explanation about this point data and aerial spatial data when we combine. Yes, we can.
Okay, thank you. Dr. Aswi for the replying the questions. So I also open the second round. So please, who will ask the question? I open the second round. Pak Anwar, maybe would you like to ask question? Still unmute? No? Okay. We still have time, so I will invite all of you to ask the questions. Okay. Otherwise, I will ask again to Professor Arasan. Yes. during you did the simulation, you use uniform distributions to make like truncated sensor data from the red sensoric and the sensoric data. Is that right? And what is the reason why you use the uniform distribution compared to the other distribution?
Sorry, can you hear me now? No, actually, yes. The simulation, I don't know which part you're talking about, but actually there are several distributions that I use in the simulation. One is simulate data from the distribution itself. That means for the, I have three models, TBIR, extreme minimum, and log logistic. So first I simulate data from all these models. And then I use the exponential to simulate the censoring data. And then to simulate the uniform distribution, I used to actually to do the imputation technique. Are you referring to that particular uniform distribution?
Yes.
The one, I use uniform because we are using survival, the estimated survival function. Okay, mm-hmm. So the estimated survival, it's kind of a probability. Okay, so estimated survival function is actually kind of probability. Probability something survives more than some value. It takes value between, because it's probability, it takes value between 0 and 1. So it's actually very useful when we use the uniform distribution to simulate this. You don't have to necessarily, but it is just very useful. Anything that deals with probability, you use the uniform distribution between certain intervals. That's the purpose. Is that what you're asking? Did I answer your question?
Yes.
Because I wanted to just, because you see, okay, let me explain in case you're interested to know. Interval censoring means when I say 44 to 48, a patient fails between 44 to 48 months, but we don't know when they fail. So usually what people do, they just say, okay, they take 44 plus 48, divide by 2, somewhere in the middle. But actually, when you say patients fail between 44 to 48, they can fail anywhere from 44 to 48. So doesn't it make sense to just simulate any value in that interval? You know what I mean? So uniform within that interval. That's the idea. So anywhere in between 44 to 48, not more to 48, not more to 45, or not more to the middle, anywhere, uniform between 44 to 48. So that's the idea. But you can change that if you want, you know, if you have other ideas, you know. Yeah. Okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's clear for me that the reason because you can be in the
anywhere. Yeah, anywhere. Yeah. So you want to give it equal probability.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. Thank you, Professor Arasan. So I'm also inspired again from the audience to the three speakers.
Did I have a question, Putan?
Yes, yes.
Thank you very much. I would like to ask to Professor Jayanti regarding your model. Have you tried to apply Bayesian methods in your survival model?
Yes, earlier on, I have actually explored some Bayesian models for survival data. But unfortunately, they are not, because you need students to work with. Bayesian is not particularly my field, but I did go into Bayesian survival. It's quite interesting, but later I had to stop it and now I don't work much because my students can't carry it. Because, you know, Bayesian as it is, it has prior, it has posterior, and you have to determine what's the prior. And imagine in survival, when you have censoring on top of truncation, on top of that, it becomes a bit complex. So I find that most of the students, they do it halfway, then they give up. And I have to complete their work. I remember actually having to complete most of their work. So I said, so I stopped at that unless I can get students. So at the moment, I'm not really looking at Bayesian survival models, but there are many people working on Bayesian survival models, if that's what you want to know.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, okay. Thank you, Professor Rahan and Dr. Aswi. So who will ask again? I invite you to ask the question or give remark or maybe future research. Okay,
I'm not sure who is this question directed to.
Yeah, okay, please.
Sorry, actually I didn't hear the question. Is it directed to me?
No. I think I just invite the audience to ask the questions. Not
okay. Sorry.
Yeah, no problem. Yeah.
Maybe from me, Dr. Utami.
Oh yes, Pak Anwar, silakan.
Yes, thank you. Thank you for your talk, Dr. Jayanti, Dr. Aswi, and also Dr. Bagus. Maybe my question is just a curious questions about the survival analysis. Maybe I missed some part of your talk, but I'm wondering why you didn't talk about the left sensory in your
Okay. Basically, Dr. Anwar, because I wanted to analyze some real data, and real data with interval sensing is very, very limited. And the data that I found, they have right and interval sensor. So there's no left sensing in the real data. So yeah, you can easily talk about left sensing, but two main reasons. One is because the non-availability of real data with left sensing and interval sensing. Second, the coxinal residual usually causes problem of excess in the coxinal residual when there's right sensing. For left sensing, we haven't figured it out yet what kind of problem it causes. Mostly the problem occurs because of right sensing, so I'm tackling that problem first. But probably in future, we can look at left sensing. Because I just started this research. So you know, when you start with right sensing first. So actually my students started with right sensing, then we moved on to including interval sensing. So after this, probably we'll move on to left sensing. So I haven't done that yet, because once you do that, you can only do that with simulation, and then you cannot show with real data, because real data is very scarce. In fact, I haven't found any real data where they have interval sensor, right sensor, and left sensing. So at the moment, so that's one of the reasons, but definitely we can extend the work to left sensing and even truncated data. That's what I mentioned that in the future work. Students can actually take up this work and analyze for left sensor, truncated data, combination, and so on. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Pak Anwar. Is it okay, or you still have any question, further questions?
It's very clear, yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, Pak Anwar. Thank you, Professor Arasan.
Yeah, I think Dr. Anwar, you also worked in survival analysis. I wonder whether you're still working in survival analysis. He used to work in our university, UPM. He was my colleague.
Thank you, doctor. Small work only on the survival. Yeah.
Okay. Maybe I would like to invite one more questions. Who will ask the question? Yes. Luhputu Widya Andiani.
Okay, thank you, Ms. Utami. I would like to ask Mr. Bagus Hartono. I'm sorry, I don't get the point. I want to ask what is used as a reference to determine that genetic algorithm is the best algorithm to determine the explanatory that most effect response variable. Thank you.
Clear enough, Bagus?
Yeah.
Hello? Yeah, please.
Yes, okay, thank you, Luhputu Widya. Basically, we did not conclude that it is the best approach. What we did is we would like to find the best arrangement, and mathematically, we see that it is an optimization problem. So because it is an optimization problem, then we can find a solution with any approach of optimization. You can use genetic algorithm. You can also implement simulated annealing or variable search algorithm or variable neighborhood search of local search or any kind of optimization algorithm, uncolony or particle swarm optimization, and you mentioned it. So, but what we did is because it is a combinatorial optimization, because we would like to find permutation of numbers 1 up to 24, then genetic algorithm would work easily to find the solution. If you use, for example, Kuko search algorithm, then it will be more complicated, but some literature said that Kuko search algorithm may have a better solution, but the algorithm is quite what is complex and not easily to understand by most of people. Genetic algorithm is an old algorithm and commonly used. It is also available in Excel, for example. If you don't have R or Python, you are not familiar with that kind of programming language, you can use Excel, because in Excel there is a add-ins that is available for us to run the genetic algorithm. I think that's my response to your question. I hope this answers your question.
Enough,
Guru Putu,
or do you still have further question?
Okay, enough, very clear. Thank you, Mr. Bagus.
Thank you.
Guru Putu, my apologies. What is your institution? Can you mention?
I'm a student of IPB University, and I work at Indraprastha University.
Okay, thank you, Guru Putu. This is the last call. Maybe still one more question. Otherwise, I will close on this really interesting session today, because it's almost 3 o'clock. Yes. Thank you for Professor Arasan, Dr. Sartono, and Dr. Asli for the nice talking. We have further information about new approach in the survival analysis and optimization method in the machine learning, and also Bayesian spatial model. So I close. Thank you very much for the three speakers, and I give the time back to Ms.
Thank you, Dr. Utami Syafitri, already lead the plenary session 2. And again, big word of thanks to three of you distinguished notable speakers, Associate Professor Dr. Jayanti Arasan from University Putra Malaysia, Dr. Bagus Sartono, MSI from IPB University Indonesia, and Dr. Asli from State University of Makassar, Indonesia, for your sharing this afternoon. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sure you will agree with me that it has truly been an honorable virtual tour to meet and learn from so many bright minds from many cities and countries, from all kinds of background and expertises. We now invite Chairman of ICSDS 2021 to deliver the certificates of appreciation to three of the invited speakers, either to the moderator. We welcome you, Dr. Anwar Fitrianto.
Thank you very much. And again, I must say thank you to all the invited speakers today, from Dr. Jayanti Arasan from the University Putra Malaysia, and Dr. Bagus Sartono from the IBB University, and Dr. Aswi for your interesting talk. Thank you very much. So let allow us to give you a token appreciation for your talk today and your contribution to the ICSDS Conference 2001. Thank you. So first, maybe for Dr. Jayanti Arasan. Thank you very much, Dr. Jayanti, for your talk today.
Thank you. That's really nice.
Yeah, thank you. The next one is for Dr. Bagus Sartono, please. Yeah, thank you, Dr. Bagus Sartono, for your talk today. And then the next one is, yeah. Next one is for Dr. Aswi. Thank you, Dr. Aswi, for your contribution for the ICSTS conference 2021. And of course, for the moderator today, Dr. Utami Diasafitri, for your guidance for this session. Thank you.
Yeah,
thank you.
You're welcome, Pak Anwar. We thank you, all of you, distinguished person. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, we are now come to the parallel session 2. There will be 3 topics to discuss in 3 different rooms. We thank you to those already rename your ID name on your each screen using format room_session_name. Again, the format is room_session_name. And parallel session 2 will divide it into 3 rooms. Room 1 will discuss under the subject survival analysis. Room 2, time series and others. Room 3, time and mixed models. One point as the program announcement I would like to deliver to you. Tomorrow, we will continue our conference as the second day as well as the closing day of the ICSDS 2021. By 8 in the morning at Jakarta time, tomorrow morning we will have the plenary session 3 and continue by parallel session 3 and plenary session 4. In the afternoon, the agenda are parallel session 4, plenary session 5, and the closing ceremony. Make sure you will attend and prepare yourself at every single session of the conference because there will be the announcement for the best paper, best presenter, best audience, and maybe another best of you. Thank you very much for your attention. Enjoy the rest of the conference and I'll see you again. Bye and good afternoon. Thank you.